Good afternoon. It's a good crowd, so delighted to have you all here. I am Prem Paul. I have the pleasure of being Vice Chancellor for Research and Economic Development. We appreciate you joining us today for our Spring Nebraska Lecture, the first of the 2016 Chancellor's Distinguished Lecture Series. Today's lecture is being web-streamed live, so I want to welcome everyone who is joining us via the web. For those of you who use social media, the Twitter hashtag for today's lecture is #NebLecture, and I've already tweeted using #NebLecture. The Nebraska Lectures are an interdisciplinary lecture series designed to foster communication among students and faculty in different academic areas and among citizens of Lincoln and Nebraska. These lectures are sponsored by the UNL Research Council in cooperation with the Chancellor's Office and Vice Chancellor for Research, our office, as well as the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute, known as OLLI. A special welcome to any OLLI members who joined us today. The Research Council is a very important council. You want to remember that, especially if you're a faculty member. They are made up of faculty from many disciplines at UNL. They solicit nominations of faculty to be Nebraska lecturers based on major recent achievements and the lecturer's ability to explain his or her own work. Selection as a Nebraska lecturer is the highest recognition of the council can bestow on an individual faculty member. They also control a lot of money. They give out the seed grants competitively, so you want to be nice to them. So if you see them, thank them. A few words about today's format. Following our lecture, Dr. Robert Powers, the chair of the Research Council and professor of chemistry, will moderate a question and answer session. Then please join us for a reception in the Nick Banquet Hall right behind the auditorium. Now it is my pleasure to introduce Harvey Perlman, UNL's chancellor and fearless leader for the past 15 years, actually 16 if you count his service as interim. Chancellor Perlman is stepping down in a couple of months, so this is the last time I get to introduce him at the Nebraska Lecture, which we worked together to establish in 2003. Chancellor Perlman is a tireless champion and an exceptional partner for UNL research. During his tenure as chancellor, our university has experienced tremendous and transformative growth with increased academic stature and research quality. Harvey, on behalf of UNL Research and the entire university, I want to thank you for all that you have done to enhance our university. Serving with you has been my personal great pleasure. So please join me in welcoming Harvey.
You know, if you are longtime attenders at this lecture, you start to believe that it's just a fraud, an excuse, so Prem can say nice things about me and I can say nice things about him, but thank you, Prem. It's my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Andrew Benson, the W.W. Marshall Distinguished Professor of Microbiology in our Department of Food Science and Technology. Dr. Benson's work is a stellar example of UNL research's far-reaching potential to vastly improve food and human health. Dr. Benson is an accomplished microbiologist focused on gut microflora, which significantly influence our health and well-being. In his lecture today, he will tell us what scientists are learning about gut bacteria and their impact on bodily functions. Throughout his UNL career, he has studied gut health and bacteria, including pathogenic microbes that invade the gut. Thanks to his expertise, Dr. Benson is a highly sought expert in litigation cases involving foodborne illnesses outbreaks across the country. He also will share some of his experiences as a food detective and explain how studying gut pathogens laid the groundwork for establishing the UNL Gut Function Initiative. That initiative's goal is to develop food-based strategies for balancing the gut ecosystem, which will provide new ways to look at disease prevention and intervention. I want to note that it's especially fitting that we host his lecture at Nebraska Innovation Campus, which is now the home to both his academic department, Food Science and Technology, and his startup company, Metagenome Analytics, LLC. He is managing partner in MGA, which is the first faculty-based startup to move into this facility. The MGA team includes UNL faculty, graduate students, and former students. The bioinformatics company's products target the food and public health sectors. Dr. Benson has been a UNL faculty member since 1996. He has a bachelor's degree in microbiology from Iowa State University and a doctorate in microbiology from the University of Texas. He was a postdoctoral fellow at Princeton before joining us here in Lincoln. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Andrew Benson, who will present Guts, Germs, and Stainless Steel, Creating Winners and Losers in Food. Andy.
Thank you, Chancellor Perlman. Thank you, Vice Chancellor Prim-Paul, for the chance to be here, and thanks everyone for showing up today. We're going to get into the title for just a minute, but guts is going to be a resounding theme, and I thought I would just show you that our administration has guts. This is a mail. I didn't have to dig out too many emails to find one of these, and this was a mail from Prim-Paul asking me to come and show up and give an after-dinner presentation to the Science for Global Policy Conference. We wanted you to speak on the gut microbiome. So after 20 years, you finally asked me this time to give a talk when it's not after dinner or around a mealtime. So we've learned how to give these talks without grossing too many people out. I have to say, I thank the good Lord every day for this group of folks that's around me. They're sitting in the middle row. A lot of them are here today. But my wife, Renee, who's been by my side since high school, there's us way back in 1984. Not too long ago, the two of us there. My son, Nathan, who's here. His girlfriend's here as well. My daughter and son-in-law, Sam. Wonderful grandchildren that we have, and mother and father. A great supportive family here in town. I couldn't do any of the stuff that I do without having them around. So thank you, guys. And it lets me start off to where this story of guts, germs, and stainless steel really starts. And that's some 20-some years ago, back in front of Kildee Hall. And this is, I think, a newer picture, Prem, of Kildee Hall. But back, it looked a little different when we were there. But my wife, Renee, and I were there. And I told her, I think I really want to be a professor. And she asked me, or she said, so what does that mean? And she's learned what that's meant now over the last 20-some-odd years. But it's been a fantastic journey that we've been on. So we're going to talk about guts, germs, and stainless steel. I'm going to reverse the order a little bit. We're going to talk about the germs first, because that came first in the career. But first, let me tell you, if you don't already know where that title comes from, I borrowed that from Jared Diamond's book. Jared Diamond's a professor of physiology at UCLA, wrote a wonderful book, Guns, Germs, and Stainless Steel. See, I'm already throwing stainless in. Guns, Germs, and Steel, several years ago, and it's a fantastic read if you're a big picture guy like I am, because he took a very big picture of trying to define the factors that explain success or failure of societies. And when you look at those factors, what it boils down to is that there were geographies where there were lots of species that were suitable for domestication. And believe it or not, there's not that many species out there that are suitable to domesticate, along with species that could spread. And that led to the early forms of agriculture, domestication of plant and animal species. That led to stores and surpluses of foods, eventually led to large, sedentary, dense populations. And with dense populations and people not having to hunt and find food all the time, it allowed for specialization. political organization and writing is one of those specializations, and we can argue about whether or not that was a good specialization, but it was useful at the time. That also led to many technological developments as well. But having man in close proximity to dense populations of animals also led to the emergence in several different types of infectious diseases and epidemic diseases. And so the wonderful, if you read through the book, it's a fantastic read on that. And so my talk today is a bit of a take on that, but really, as I sat and thought about this, the same things that made society successful a long time ago are probably the same things that are killing us today. Now think about that. We have sedentary populations with large surpluses of foods. We now have centralized production, globalized sourcing, that definitely influences pathogen emergence and evolution, and certainly contributes to foodborne illness. What's a bigger problem, however, is with types of things that have gone into our food production technologies. The way we're making our foods, the ingredients we're making them with. We're going to learn about a couple of words today called microbiome dysbiosis, and the fact that that's contributing to a large increase in lifestyle diseases, complex diseases here in the United States. So it's kind of ironic that the same things that made us successful, in a sense, are also leading to our demise. Now, I started my career here at the university at a very fortunate time, and I thought it would be good to just throw a timeline up to throw in some of the major events for folks in the room that are familiar with biology to be aware of. But right about when I got my bachelor's degree, not long after that, Francis Collins discovered the cystic fibrosis transmembrane receptor, or CFTR gene, that's the causative gene for cystic fibrosis. And in 1995, right before I arrived here, the first whole genome of a bacterium was sequenced. And that was a pretty exciting time in the microbiology and in biological sciences and in general. Not long after I arrived in 2001, we had the draft of the human genome that was published. And by 2005, next generation sequencing had been described, and I'll say just a little bit about that later. And by 2007, complex communities were already being sequenced. So, having started my career here at UNL in 1996 and been a postdoc prior to that, graduate student prior to that, this whole time, this science of genomics, DNA sequencing was evolving. And so it was really fortunate to be a part of that, to be a part of educational process and an academic process during that time when these things were coming online. In 1997, there was a watershed event that happened a year after I'd arrived here at UNL. And this sets the stage for the germs portion of the talk. And in 1997, there was a recall event, the Hudson recall event, was the largest recall at the time, 25 million pounds of ground beef, that was contaminated with enterohemorrhagic E. coli. I'm going to introduce you to this organism here in just a minute. But note what this recall caused, because there was a remarkable amount of meat that was being processed at that plant. Here we said Burger King said 1,600 restaurants were initially affected. It was probably more than that. A lot of the major stores, Safeway, Walmart, Boston, were simply out of ground beef for a period of time. So it sort of put things in perspective, especially for me as a young faculty member, to appreciate the impact of that on our economy in the state. And so that really turned my attention towards this organism. And I had already been talking to Charlie Casper up at the University of Wisconsin, who was working on field epidemiology of this organism. Now let's talk just briefly about this bacterium. This is an organism that has passed, or is largely has its reservoir in bovine, and it's passed from bovine into humans, either through contaminated food most commonly. It can get into land environments and contaminate food that way indirectly. It can directly contaminate individuals from direct contact as well. And the organism is not like most E. coli. Most E. coli are harmless inhabitants of the GI tract. This is a very pathogenic form. It's a form that's acquired several sets of virulence genes that allows it to do some special things. One is to attach to your colon. Another one is to produce toxins that cause massive inflammation in different parts of your body. Well, Charlie Casper was studying this organism, And he was looking at the genetic fingerprints, and these are just to simply think of these as barcodes. These are genetic fingerprints of the organism. And what he noted was that even on a single farm, one could identify several different subtypes of this organism. And to me, that led to a really remarkable question it made us think about, and that is, are all of these guys equally likely to cause disease? So I've simplified those fingerprints just by showing them to you as colors now in the guts of these animals. And are we seeing all of the same ones in animals show up in humans? And we really didn't know the answer to that question, and we didn't even have a method to answer that question at that point in time. A method I'm going to tell you and show you about in a minute simply couldn't let us predict the ancestry, and you're going to understand what that means here in a second. The methods that were based on short segments, there wasn't enough resolution, and whole genome sequencing was still way too expensive to do at the time. There was no way we could do it. Certainly not do it here at this institution with the capabilities that we had. So that forced us to be bold and innovative and develop the method that would let us answer the question. Now, as I talk about this, I want to walk you through this. This is going to help set the stage for things later on, but I think it'll help you appreciate a little bit about genome biology. So everybody will have a take-home today. Maybe we'll have an exam on this afterwards. But let's put it into perspective. So first of all, taxonomy. We have to talk about classifying organisms quickly. And here's taxonomy, and we can compare E. coli to a book. This makes life simple for us, because everybody understands how to classify a book. And I chose a book, The Wonderful Wizard of Oz, and here's how one might classify that book. And we can go down through different layers of the classification that reflect the taxonomic levels that we use to classify microorganisms. The genome here is the word content of the book. And there's the word content from a page, Wonderful Wizard of Oz. And the genome here is the DNA sequence of E. coli. As you can see, the two are not that different, right? There's just fewer characters. There's only four different letters in the alphabet of a DNA sequence. Many more characters here in our alphabet that we use. So these two are equivalent here. Think of them that way. So we've got that part of the metaphor going. And to understand how genomes evolve, let's look at how this book evolved into a lot of different forms of even different types of media. From 1899, the original book, all the way to 1930, probably didn't change too much. There were a few different editions that were put out, and we can think of these as the normal forms of E. coli. There's a few little word changes here and there, but not tremendous changes. 1939 was the film version. Obviously, the manuscript from that film version was tremendously different than the original book. And then from that launched a couple of different Broadway versions, The Wiz, a theatrical version in 2011, and then Wicked, of course, in 2003. And these would represent the pathogenic E. coli because these are quite divergent from the original E. coli strains. Now everybody, we put that into perspective. Now if we were to take the way we were thinking of the genome and the way we're thinking of books, and I said, I want you to take these books without knowing when they were made, and I want you to put them in the order in which they were produced. Put them in the chronological order in which these books were produced. What you would not do is to look at the chapter links of the book, right? That's probably not how you would do it. But that's essentially what the methodology at the time was doing. The genome methodology that we had at the time that was used by CDC, it's still used by CDC today, it's very good at being able to differentiate the books, but I would have a very hard time putting them in order just based on the length of their pages. And so that was a problem to us, and we started thinking about how are we going to get around this? And Joe Niedfeld and I were at a conference in 1996, late 96, early 97, and we were starting to think about this, and they were describing the genome of E. coli. It hadn't quite been published yet, and they were describing some characteristics of it. And Fred Blattner from the University of Wisconsin was talking about these frequently occurring words. You can think of them as frequent words. They're actually called pseudoligomers, but let's think of them as words. They're frequently occurring words. They're tremendously overrepresented in that genome. And so if I were to draw arrows around this circular genome where these words occurred, you'd see they'd be all over the place in this genome. And what Joe and I thought of is that we could use these words to fragment this genome into very specific pieces and thousands of little pieces. And it became a way for us to do comparative genomics. And I have to stop here and mention that Joe Neufeld has been with me for 20 years in my laboratory, has been a laboratory manager, and Joe is retiring at the end of this year in June. So that's almost like losing a family member. So he's been a tremendous resource to my laboratory, and I want to make sure that Joe can remember back to this day when we were at this conference, and we came up with, or we hatched this plot, I should say, we came up with this idea. But Joe, thank you for all of the years of tremendous work that you've done in my group and for the whole department, literally. You've been a tremendous resource. So now we have these overrepresented words, and overrepresented words would be like and the, than, this, right? Those are words that are overrepresented in a book. They're used frequently, right? And so what I've done is show you what this little method that we developed does. Here's the segment of our book now, and length between occurrences of and there's the sentence right there. And here in the genome now, our word's not hand, we use different words in the genome. And here's the segment that's occurring between TCTTTGC. And there's the length of the piece right there. So this is how we were able to fragment the genome, and I won't bore you with the details of exactly how the fragmentation was done, but I'll let you know we fragmented the genomes on these, and we separated these on these LiCor, on these machines from LiCor. They were automated DNA sequencers at the time, fantastic machines, and it would develop these wonderful images like this. And these are the fragmentation patterns. Each little line here is a different strain of E. coli that we're looking at. So you can see we could look at lots of strains at one point, at one time, and we could compare thousands of different segments of the genome, one to another, extremely high resolution. And we had to do this by hand because at the time there was no image analysis software that could handle this data, even though these machines were capable of producing fantastic data. And so Jaehom Kim and I would sit in my office. We always did this at the end of the day. We'd start about 2 o'clock in the afternoon because after doing this for 3 hours, you couldn't take it anymore. One person would read up the image, calling ones and zeros for binaries, and the other person would be typing it into a spreadsheet. So we did that for hours and hours and days upon end. But we could see already the pattern that was emerging. So let's go back to the question now. Remember, the question was, are there the same populations in bovine, are all of them still showing up in humans? And the answer to that question we could already see as we were analyzing these images was, well, yes and no. In fact, what we found was that there were two very distinct subpopulations of the organism, and one was clearly overrepresented in the bovine population, was underrepresented among isolates from humans. And you can look at the length of the bases. This is the amount of the genome that we were comparing. It was a tremendous amount of the genome we were comparing at exquisitely high resolution at the time. Now, we went on, just quickly, to show a couple of different things. First of all, that this divergence event was ancestral, meaning that it had happened a long time ago. And we knew that because we could detect descendants of this event on different parts of the planet. Specifically, we looked down in Australia, we looked in UK, we looked in the United States. We had representation across different locations, across different geographies. So it was an ancestral event that happened some time ago. And secondarily, the thing we found was that the diversity that it was causing was creating diversity in the expression of genes that this organism uses to attach to the colon, which was a remarkable find to us. So the diversity that was happening because of this, because of the genetic differences between these strains, was causing differences in their ability to form these specialized attachment structures. And this is important because those structures are used not only to attach to your colon to help cause disease, they're also used by that organism to attach to the colon of the animals that they reside in their reservoir. And so literally what the organism is doing is it's identified ways that it can evolve and it can manipulate gene expression patterns to optimize its ability to attach in the bovine environment. And that somehow has an impact on the humans as well. So to us, this was remarkable to be able to find this over a period of several different years across these different studies that we had done. And we played this game in multiple organisms at the time, several different pathogens. I don't want to bore you with this. But in about 2005, something happened that just leveled the playing field in DNA sequencing, and it completely changed what we thought about and what I thought about in terms of food science. And that was a publication that came out describing the first of the next generation sequencers. And this is that actual publication here. And this next generation sequencing parallelized the DNA sequencing process. That's all you really need to understand about it. But it made it so that it was literally available to the common man, which was us. And once that happened, it definitely leveled the playing field in terms of the types of science that we could do and the things that we could approach. Here's what it allowed us to do. Rather than looking at fragmentation patterns in my office going crazy in the afternoons, 3 hours at a time, just to compare maybe one genome, we could sequence the genomes that would essentially represent entire libraries. We could sequence entire communities and define the content of that library. And I'm going to switch from books now to a little better visual, and that is colored gumballs, because that's a little easier to think of when we're thinking of communities. So we could use DNA sequencing as an analytical tool now, and we could define the populations of organisms in these complex communities. And to us, that was just a tremendous capability. And let me tell you, to describe what it was like the first time to look at that kind of data was mind-blowing. It was so exciting, because you almost had to pinch yourself to tell yourself this was real. People have dreamed of this kind of thing for 200 years, and now you have the opportunity to actually look at that kind of data. And as we sat and thought about this in the food science department, Bob Hudkins and I started thinking that, wow, this meant that we could systematically look at these entire microbial populations and ecosystems, one of them being in the GI tract. And it would let us explore this whole black box known as the gut microbiome. And when we think about nutrition, we think about health, we think about food, a fair amount was known about the host factors that were involved, and a fair amount was known about diet and some of the environmental factors, but the composition of the microbiome was a black box. People had no way to study this complex community for a long time. So to us, this was pretty exciting. And this next slide represents a remarkable time for us at UNL in 2007 to 2009. And a community of the university community really rallied around this idea of studying the gut microbiome. And we were able to hire two researchers out of some of the top gut laboratories in the world, because we were very early in this game of thinking about studying the gut microbiome, Jens Walter and Dan Peterson. And what was remarkable about those recruitment processes was that first of all, we had a department head who had just walked in the door. So he literally walked into the door and has to see, oh my gosh, I've got guys wanting to study guts here. And our department head was a food engineer. So we have to appreciate the fact that he put his arms around this and was able to support this. We had folks from the Center for Plant Science and Innovation, which was actually called the Plant Science Initiative at the time, that were involved in helping us recruit. I can still remember Sally McKenzie, who was the director at that time, coming to the seminars and meeting with these guys. We had folks from the Center for Biotechnology that were involved in the recruiting process. And we've had folks from here in the community. And I had to show Dr. Doug Dahlke's picture up here. Doug was a gastroenterologist here in town. He was my gastroenterologist, and I'm betting that there's more than one of us in this room that has seen Dr. Dahlke over their period of their life. And Dr. Dahlke was killed tragically in a car accident 2 years ago, and that was a great loss to this community. But he was there. He was at the seminars of these guys, and it's remarkable that somebody who's an MD who's out in our community would take the time to come meet with these individuals and would take the time to be involved in this recruiting process. So I want to make sure to give tribute to him, because that was very much appreciated. Well, by 2008, we actually had an initiative, and it started to get scary because we called this the Gut Function Initiative, and all of a sudden everybody was talking about it, and that's kind of scary because it's got a life of its own all of a sudden. It's not just you trying to sell it. And we even had some concepts that we were wrapping our heads around. First of all, we're science-driven. We're focused on the three main factors, the host factors, the microbial factors, and the dietary factors that allow this ecosystem to function. And we're also translation-focused. We want to turn this knowledge into something. We're focused on developing novel probiomicrobials or antimicrobials, novel prebiotics, as well as potential animal breeding markers. And we were on the cover of the Lincoln Journal Star, and this is a photo of us here. And I'll have to say, this is one of multiple wardrobe malfunctions that all of us had. Because, and looking at that photo, it's just like, wow. That was on the cover of LJS. But one of many wardrobe malfunctions to come. But it was an interesting time when that group came together. It wasn't just us. We had some remarkable resources that we were endowed with here in the university. By 2008, we had one of these next-generation sequencers that was up in when the Food Science Department was still in Philly Hall. It was number 100 in the world, believe it or not. That was the 100th machine in the world that we had here. That's how far ahead of the game we were with this initiative. We had a germ-free mouse facility that allows us to propagate mice germ-free and allows us to introduce organisms into them in ways that allow us to test hypotheses. We had a wonderful bioinformatics and supercomputing community that we were able to interface with to get all of our bioinformatics work done that we needed to do. We had a food processing center that allowed us to develop foods that could be used in some of the human studies that have been done by some of my colleagues. And we also have the Center for Biotechnology, which has some of the core facilities that are used as well by this group. So we had this remarkable set of infrastructure swirling around us. So let's get started with some gut microbiome basics before we dive into the good stuff. So first of all, many of you might know this already because it's such a popular topic. There's certainly lots of organisms that are there. Indeed, there's tens to hundreds of trillions of bacteria there. They outnumber our cells by 10 to 100-fold. Their genomic content is 100 times or so what we have in our own genomes. In fact, we think of them as an entire metabolic organ. They have complete metabolic pathways that we don't have, and they help our bodies do things that our bodies cannot do. So things that are not encoded within our genome. There's about 500 to around 2,000 different species in any one individual, if I went and looked, and we could. They're present at different proportions, just like the gumballs that I showed you. I wanted to get that visual in your mind. And the species composition of every individual in this room is unique. It's as unique as your fingerprint is. All right, so you have this own little ecosystem that's present in your GI tract, and it's doing a lot of different things, some of which we're just learning. But one thing we do know for sure is that balance in this ecosystem is really important. And balance doesn't mean everybody's present at the same proportions. It just means that the ecosystem is functioning as a balanced ecosystem. And when it's doing that, it's important, or it's contributing to development of the immune system. It's contributing to development of actual gut tissue. The gut tissue won't develop properly without a microbiome. It's contributing to nutrient acquisition, to function of your gut, motility, electrolyte balance, resistance to infectious diseases, detoxification of things that we might ingest, as well as contributing to host metabolism. All these things the microbiome is doing. And in fact, animals that lack the microbiome, these germ-free animals, they're weird. They are not normal animals. You'll find that there are defects in all of these different circles in an animal that lacks a microbiome. So it's playing a very, very important role in our bodies. And when it gets out of balance, it can get out of balance in a couple of different types of forms. In one form, it causes sort of local defects, and those local defects translate into inflammatory bowel diseases, chronic C. diff infection, gastrointestinal cancers, necrotizing enterocolitis. These are examples of things that happen in the locally and in the GI tract when the gut microbiome is out of balance. And it can also have effects at distal sites, and these tend to be metabolic defects. So it's involved in coronary artery disease or coronary heart disease, obesity, metabolic diseases in both type 1 and type 2 diabetes. So defects in the microbiome are associated with all of these different types of diseases. Now, the causality is still not quite well understood because that's really difficult to determine whether the messed up microbiome is what's causing the disease or whether it's an effect of the disease. But in certain cases, we know that it's certainly a cause. So that made us start to ask the question, well, what factors actually govern assembly of this thing? How does this microbiome actually come together in an individual? And what happens that causes this dysbiosis? Or what happens when things go awry? And you can put those factors, again, into those three different balls, the host factors, the microbial factors, and the diet, environment, and ecological factors. And if you talk to and look at individuals that are with part of the gut microbiome group or the gut function group, you'll find that they are in one of these balls working and sometimes crossing over multiple balls. I'm going to tell you a little quick story or a couple of quick stories about some of the balls we did. I want to tell you about one of the things that led us to think about that a few years ago. This got us started down looking at the host genetic contribution to that. We were working with Merlin Nielsen over in Animal Science. Merlin had a population of mice that he had selectively bred for multiple generations to study caloric utilization and feed intake. And Jens Walter and I were starting to look at the microbiome of those animals, and this was before we had the sequencing in place, and so each little line here represents a different organism, each strip is a different mouse. And we were comparing the outbred populations that he had used here in his selection processes to some of the inbred populations that he had here. And this was a day, because I can still remember looking at this image as we walked back from the animal science department, and this tells you something about how different people view the outcome of an experiment. Because Jens was focused on the experiment at hand, and his expression was verdammt, which I think that's how you pronounce it, which is a German expression. You can look that one up and see what it means, but darn it would be a good translation. There's too much variability in these animals here. It won't be easy to do the experiment in these animals. And I looked at it and I thought, wow, if you compare the inbreds to the outbreds, that tells me that genetics must be a real big factor here. And that's something we ought to go after. So diversity, I say this often, diversity is a currency of creativity, and it truly is. So diversity in thought and diversity of the way we may look at outcomes is important. So how do you study that? How do you get at that? How are you going to study whether host genetics is a contributing factor? How do you get at these complex genetic effects? Well, first of all, let's understand what a complex trait actually is. Complex traits arise from variation in genetic factors and environmental factors. And variation in the genetic and the environmental factors come together in populations of individuals to bring about a distribution of traits. And I've got a couple of extremes of distribution in terms of height, and height is a very good example of a complex trait. And it's funny, when I show these to students in classes, they have no earthly idea who these people are when you point that out. That's Willie Shoemaker, Will Chamberlain and Willie Shoemaker there. But they would be on the extremes of this distribution curve across our population. And height is definitely a complex trait. There are hundreds of genes that contribute to height, as well as many different environmental factors as well. So it's the convergence of those two that bring about that trait in an individual and bring about the population of traits across individuals. And so I called up our friend Daniel Pomp, who I, at the time, was working on obesity and exercise characteristics in mice, and I told him we were interested in studying, getting at whether or not genetics has a contribution or makes a measurable contribution to the microbiome. And Daniel was very excited because he'd been thinking about this too. And Daniel actually used to be here in the animal science department many years ago, and he's out in North Carolina right now. But Daniel also had the perfect experiment underway in which we could test this hypothesis. And so it was a remarkable time, almost a marriage made in heaven when I called him. And the study is this. He has two different mouse lines that he had crossed, and we're just going to represent them by two chromosomes from each to keep things simple. The yellow, which is the C57 black 6 line, and the blue, which was HR, and that stands for high running. This was a line that has been selected for its running characteristics. And these are literally marathon runners of mice. And now you can think about the progeny of these animals that are coming out. And instead of looking at height or weight of these animals, we're looking at different organisms in their guts, and we're measuring their abundances. And you can see that we have a distribution. This is the number of animals, and this is the relative abundance down here. We have a distribution just like we would get if we were looking at height or any other complex trait. And so these microorganisms and their abundances became the traits. And we studied them as traits. And the only thing I'll tell you more about the analysis is just to know that it's a statistical association between the abundance of these traits and the movement of different segments of the chromosomes from these parents and the progeny of the animals. And sure enough, we found that indeed there were several different positions in the mouse chromosome where we could identify variation in those animals that was contributing to that variation in the gut microbiome. And each different line here, these are the mouse chromosomes shown around the outside, each different line here represents a different place in the chromosome that affected that, and the different organisms that they're infecting are represented by this phylogram, and they're colored here, color-coded according to the organism that's being controlled. And this publication, this bit of data was published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science, and this figure has actually become iconic because it was a way of representing at the time a host organism controlling a set of microorganisms within it. So it was kind of a neat representation. That's about as artistic as you'll see the gut group get. Remember, we're challenged in terms of even dressing ourselves. So, but this was a widely recognized discovery. This was pointed out in Nature Reviews Microbiology. And there were several discoveries coming out of the group. This wasn't the only one. There was three big discoveries that came out of the group at this time within about a 2 or 3 year span. This was just one of them. Jens Walther had another one, and Dan Peterson did as well. So there were remarkable things coming out of this group. We did a subsequent study where we introduced a dietary challenge into the animals, and so we split the animals, the progeny, half of them put on high-fat diets, half of them put on 20. And the only thing I'll say quickly about this is that we found three different positions where the genetics was showing an interaction effect with diet. And what that means, what's the take-home is from that, is that diet can potentially use to overcome genetic defects that cause dysbiosis. And that's good news, because that means if we can understand how that process works, we can potentially develop diets and dietary molecules that could be used to perturb the microbiome or reconfigure it back into a form that would be beneficial for the host, not detrimental. I want to show you one quick study, and we're going to zoom through some cool slides, and I had to show these next few just for the wow factor, because this is where we are right now in these studies. So this is a very complex population of mice that we're working on. The ones I was talking about previously don't really reflect the genetics of a human population. And we wanted something that reflects the genetics of a human population. And so they've gone to another model here. This is called the diversity outbred. And it begins with 8 different progenitor lines. So this is a multi-parent cross that's done. And these 8 lines have as much genetic diversity between them as you can get. So almost think of it as 8 different races or 8 different nationalities of humans, if you will. They've been bred together and randomized totally. And this is what their chromosomes look like. If we color code each of these animals with a color, this is what their chromosomes, it's a patchwork, just like our chromosomes would look like if we looked at the ancestry of our chromosomes. And in fact, these are 2 different litters that are coming out. This is one litter right here. This is another litter. I mean, if you can imagine, look at the diversity that's showing up in there in terms of color, the sizes of those animals, tremendous diversity represented in this population of animals. So it starts to reflect what a human population actually looks like. And so the study in this population that we've been looking at here the last couple of years, 300 animals on a purified diet. After 6 weeks, they've been split into 2 populations. Half of those animals were on a high-fat plus folic acid diet. That's an atherogenic, or a diet that will generate atherosclerosis in those animals. And the other half was put onto a high-protein diet. And these animals were sampled at 3 different time points for lots of different things, including the microbiome. Now, we're going to represent the microbiome a different way. And again, this is for the wow factor. You don't have to understand this, but follow the balls. That's all you have to do. If you follow the balls, you'll be okay. What these are network diagrams that represent the co-occurrences of these organisms. So all the organisms that you see, each of these is a different species. And these guys co-occur together across that population of animals. It means if you see one, you see all the rest of them, okay? And if one of them increases in an abundance, the other ones do too. Okay, so they co-occur together. And we could split them into four different groups, of we call core groups, core group one, core group two, three, and four. And don't worry about the guys that are the other colors at this point. This is what the situation looks like initially before we switch the diet on them. And as we switch the diet, that situation changes. So here's our reference set right there, the green ones. And after you switch the diet onto high fat, it shifts like this. You'll see this green one gets disrupted. And at 24 weeks, it shifts back again. And if we do it on high protein, it looks a little bit different. Now I'm just going to sit here and flip back and forth between this because that lets you really start to see what's going on. Right? You can see what's happening here when you start to flip that. The diet or the microbiome is shifting dramatically in response to the diet. And you can see this core group here splits into two and sort of resolves again here at 24 weeks. And then a high protein situation is quite a bit different. So we can track these organisms just by putting them into these core groups based on their behavior. And that's important because we could categorize them. Being able to categorize them was critical to being able to understand or do the analysis. Now here's another slide, again, I showed just for the wow factor, but it's the genetic map now of all the places on the chromosomes of these animals that we saw affecting these particular core groups. And all you really need to follow is the red and the green. So this is our diet before the shift, or this is the animals before the shift, and this is after the shift. And these are our five different core groups in the different rings. The different chromosomes are shown around here in the circle. Don't worry about the color of the chromosomes. All you need to know is red is when there's a genetic effect and it's significant, and green is, meaning it's going away. So there's the heat map right there from high to low. And what you'll notice if you look around here is that in most cases, diet completely abolishes the genetic effect. After we shift the diet, we can no longer see that genetic effect. And again, remember I said there's a diet gene by diet interaction. That's actually a good thing because it tells us that we may be able to overcome genetic effects with diet. But there's one case over here, right here in particular, where diet actually unmasks the genetic effect. So it can do two different things. In some instances, it'll abolish the genetic effect. In other cases, it'll actually reveal the genetic impact. So two different things that the diet can do. Now, in addition to just the microbiome, that same position that we were looking at, that I was pointing to on chromosome 13, it affects the green balls, the green core group. It also controls fat content and body mass. Those same traits map to that same position. And it tells you that the same genes, or the genes that are underlying this, are contributing to both the microbiome composition as well as fat mass and body content. That's interesting. And we can sort of draw this down here in a chromosome representation now and think of this as three very different types of traits, a microbiome trait, a host metabolic trait, and disease predisposition traits. And if I do that, what you'll see is that this starts to look very much like what's known as pleiotropy. It starts to look very much like the anatomy of complex diseases that we see in humans. This is a figure from inflammatory bowel disease and the multiple loci that are involved in predisposition to inflammatory bowel disease. Many of those loci are contributing to host metabolic and immune dysfunction in these individuals. They also predispose them to dysbiosis in the microbiome as well. And altogether, these cause or predispose these individuals to disease. So this really starts to look a lot like what a complex disease really translates into humans. Now remember, with dietary modulation, we have hope because that will allow us to, or could potentially allow us to overcome disease predisposition. And now we can think about doing it in multiple ways. And this is an entirely different way of thinking about treating disease. We're not talking about treating a disease with a medicine. We're talking about treating a disease with a dietary modulation that can impact the microbiome and can also impact potentially or overcome the effects of genetic predisposition. But we still have a lot to learn in order to be able to do that. So what we know, for sure, dietary modulation can have significant health outcomes. This was an experiment done with Jens Walter and by Devin Rose, one of the newer members of the gut group. And this was just simply a whole grain diet, looking at different types of whole grain diets, and now doing detailed studies on the microbiome of these individuals, as well as measuring health characteristics in them, and showing that there are very specific changes going on in the microbiome, and that there are also very specific changes going on in terms of the host health and the inflammatory tone, and you can start to connect changes in the microbiome with those changes in the inflammatory tone. So that gives you the idea that we could very systematically begin to modulate the microbiome through dietary changes. Other studies from Bob Hutkin's group, from Jens Walter's group, both showing that you could use things called prebiotics. These are non-digestible fibers that could be introduced into the diets of humans, and that those would cause very specific changes in the microbiome. Very specific organisms could be changed in their abundances and could be modulated up and down with these particular dietary changes. And one of the things that was seen in both of those studies is this phenomenon of responders and non-responders. There's always populations of the people that will respond to that diet, but there's always a percentage of the individuals that don't respond to that challenge as well. And we don't quite know what that means. So part of the road ahead of us lies in understanding what's the difference between a responder and a non-responder. And one last little thing I'll show here quickly from, again, one of the newer gut lab group members, Dr. Amanda Raymer Tate. And this is the fact that some of these compounds that we thought required or had to be digested by the microbiome to have an effect on health, that in fact there are microbiome dependent and independent pathways through which these things can impact our health. And all you need to do is follow the colors here again, that a resistant starch can have an impact on appetite and glucose homeostasis, both through the microbiome, but it can also do it independently of the microbiome. And part of that depends on genetics, depends on which animal line you do the experiment in. So these are three different big picture things that have come out of that group in the last few years to tell us about how this dietary modulation works and what we've got to learn to do this. Now, that gets us back to stainless steel. And one of my collaborators is asking me, what does stainless steel represent? In the title, it means the food. Stainless steel is used in food production. So that represents the food in the title. And one of the things that's happened over the last several thousand years, and this was put out last year by Justin Sonnenberg's group, is that as our diet has changed, it's been reduced in terms of its diversity dramatically over a period of time. And especially if you look at 400 years ago with the introduction of industrialized food and now processed food and highly sanitized foods, the diversity, the terms of molecular diversity that's present in our food system, in our food supply, is actually quite low. And that, coupled with increased sanitation, use of antibiotics, C-sections and formula, has also dramatically reduced the diversity of microorganisms in our GI tract. And when you put the combination of those two things together, it's not surprising that a lot of these lifestyle diseases that we're genetically susceptible to, that we have susceptibility to in our population, it's not surprising they're growing in epidemic proportions in our culture. And it's not a big surprise why that's such a burden on our health care. This is a study put out from the Institute of Medicine and the National Academy of Sciences. This is the food system. So if you look at our food production system, I challenge you to find the words health and nutrition in here. I made it big so you could see it, right? I challenge you to find those words in there. They're in there. A little bit in policy, nutrition here and health, that's to keep the stuff from killing us. That's not so much to promote health. So our food system is driven by a whole lot of factors, very few of which actually have anything to do with health or health care. And that's despite the fact that health care now and health is a major outcome of our food system. So this is the calories in the food supply, the total food expenditures. It's kind of nice to see those tracking together. Food away from home, that would be, some of that would be food while you're on the vehicle as well. And obesity, and I could plot multiple diseases on the same thing that are showing that same exact trend. This is the system that we've created, the system that we're in right now. And we wonder why some of these diseases are increasing the way they are. Well, just last year, as was mentioned to you, the Department of Food Science and Technology was moved out here to Innovation Camp, Nebraska Innovation Campus. And there's more than just the gut group within this department. There are some remarkable groups in this Department of Food Allergen Research and Resource Program, a wonderful applied research and engineering group. We have the Food Processing Center, as well as natural product and food analysis. And this isn't even all the representation out here. And with us being out here, it really makes us start to think about how can we address this problem systematically? How can we start approaching this systematically? We have this well-established gut group. We have these new facilities that are unique out here at Innovation Campus. And one of the cool things that we have is a human clinical translational facility where we can do feeding studies here. We can bring individuals in, we can do feeding studies, and we can also do some types of small amounts of medical work on the individuals as well, so that we can get biomedical information on individuals, we can develop foods, we can do feeding studies, we have the analytical capabilities surrounding that, and that's sitting right out here just off to our south. We have a very well-established plant sciences and data sciences group, and we have another remarkable facility sitting over here in the phenotype, the plant phenotyping facility. If you haven't seen that, it's a fantastic facility to see. It's also really cool at night when it's lit up with the blue lights as well, if you've been by at night. We have the agricultural engine of a land-grant institution, meaning that if we take a discovery, we can turn it into something that like a plant or products derived from plants or animals, and we can do that in a hurry. We have a medical center that has very, very unique expertise and very unique populations in which to study. I'm going to come back to that one in a minute as well. And we even have unique non-human primate facilities that exist over in Omaha. And we also had this opportunity for capacity building. And so this was campus-level endeavors that were going on that really stimulated us to start thinking about how can we put all this together systematically. Well, where are the rate-limiting gaps? Where we need to speed things up? Well, first of all, this number of food molecules with known effects is really small. Less than 10. So it's a small number of compounds that we know we can feed an individual and have predictable outcomes. So we need to increase the number of these things dramatically. Secondly, they're not acting in by themselves. They're acting in combinations, and so they're having multifactorial interactions. We need to understand how that works. And then lastly, we have individualized responses. Each individual responds a little bit differently. We need to understand these three things, and we need to approach this systematically. How do we do that? We do that by turning the university into a discovery and translation pipeline. This is all sitting here. It's all sitting around us. We can do plant genotype. We have this tremendous resource in plant genetic and phenotypic diversity with all the breeding programs, all the plant sciences. We'll have to show you that in just a minute. We can take that and use it to identify variants in these plants that actually cause perturbations in the microbiome. We can be real systematic about identifying plants that have compounds in them that do that. The next step then is to identify the actual molecules that are causing the perturbations, and next thing you know, we're holding a whole bunch of candidate molecules in our hands. And we can do all of this just with genetics up here on top. The translation pipeline, once we have those candidate molecules, now we can test them in mouse models. We can scale up then and move them into non-human primate models to use as a transition because there's a little bit of evolutionary distance between primates and mice. And then finally, we can introduce them into healthy human populations as well and start to learn what these predictable outcomes will look like. So this is just a group that's starting to form right now. This is a plant molecular diversity group that are looking at the genetic resource populations and targeted populations that we have in plants And we're using and developing and using an in vitro screen of the microbiome so we can identify the differences here that are perturbing or cause different perturbations in these microbiome. And we can use genetics then to map back and identify the actual genes and pathways that are causing this perturbation. This can be done extremely systematically, all be done through high-throughput automated systems. We can also now combine or scale up and study, once we've identified these compounds, we can scale up studies in notobiotic mice that are carrying human gut microbiomes, so they're mice that resemble a human GI tract. We can study their ability to modify the microbiome in non-human primates, and then lastly, we can study them in healthy human populations. And so we can start to scale this across both mice all the way up into humans to really understand this responder, non-responder business, and how can we take an individual and predict which category they'll be in. And we can learn to do that at all different scales. And this involves several different individuals here on campus, as well as our friends at the University of Nebraska, Omaha, in particular Jeff French and Sid Biaretti, who have access to these animal populations and have very specialized resources and resource populations present over in Omaha that can be used for this. And lastly, we have groups at the medical center, and the group that we've been working with the most here is Dr. Eric Rush and Tanner Hegelstrom that are involved in the Monroe-Meyer Institute, and that's a genetic medicine group, and the genetic medicine group interacts with lots of different groups over in Omaha, so it was a nice portal into the clinics over there. But one of the studies or one of the diseases that we're starting to look at, in addition to looking at the inflammatory bowel disease and metabolic diseases, is a particular type of disease called cardiomyopathy, and this is a familial form, so it's an inherited form of cardiomyopathy, and cardiomyopathy occurs when you get a swelling of the left ventricle and the heart, and this ultimately leads to heart defect and heart dysfunction, and these individuals have very poor outcomes by the age of 30 to 50 years of age. So about 30% of these cases are familial, and there's a whole bunch of genes that have been identified that will cause this type of dysfunction just simply if you have a mutation in one of these genes. But several of those genes, or I should mention that just because you have the mutation doesn't mean you'll come down with the disease. So it's called incomplete penetrance. And so there's this sort of missing factor to the equation here, and the question is whether microbiome could be part of that. And when you look at several of these diseases or several of these genes that are involved in that disease, the ones in green here are actually highly expressed in the colon and suggested to it that in addition to heart defects, we could also have these individuals with disruptions in their colon function, disruptions in gut permeability, and secondary dysbiosis contributing to the disease. Now, the reason we also chose this disease is it's a little bit risky, but the reason we also chose it was because if, in fact, this is the case, imagine being able to treat one of these individuals. Now, we're not going to cure the disease, but imagine, if you will, being able to treat one of these individuals and perhaps extend their life by simply changing their diet. That's a completely different way of thinking about treating these diseases. And that's what gets us excited about this. And I know it's been a big deck of slides, and we're just about done, because this is the one I think that really gets us going. But I want to say, you know, after you've seen all this, that Nebraska should be the one to lead this cultural change. It's going to take a cultural change to think about producing these kinds of foods. Because we've usually been focused on production and yield traits. That's the typical focus of our food production. But how about health-promoting traits? And not just simple traits, but traits that are involved in making foods that are clinically proven to have beneficial effects on health. And this can be targeted for multiple types of targets, not just the Western disease challenges that we face here, but third world challenges, food animal production even, challenges. The same system can be targeted at all of these. And that targeting starts all the way back in here in the screen. So it's going to cost a bit for us to think about that, to do this. It's going to cause and require a bit of cultural change in terms of thinking about why we make the foods that we should. And I say we should lead the world in how to make the food that we should, not just by making the food that we can. Let's make the food we should make here in Nebraska, not just the food we can make. Let's make it for the right reason and put it in all the right places. I think that's our challenge. And it's not by accident that we're standing and we're all sitting here at Nebraska Innovation Campus while we think about that challenge, that this is the place to do it. I don't know about you, but I'm just going to say, are you in? Who's in? Real quick, just there's a whole bunch of people I need to thank that are listed on this slide, and I just want to point out just a couple of people very, very quickly, and I'll let it sit up here for people to look at. But I definitely want to thank Bob Hutkins, who has been a mentor to me and a colleague for many, many years here at this institution, and it's been fantastic to work with him. Daniel Pomp, who's now at North Carolina, who's also been a fantastic mentor to me, both on the academic side and to some degree on the business side as well. Charlie Casper, who was one of the individuals that actually suggested I come to Nebraska several years ago and was a mentor, and he goes all the way back to my days at Iowa State, as well as Tom Silhavy at Princeton and Bill Haldenwang, who was my graduate mentor. So just wanted to pass that out real quick. Thanks.
So thank you, Annie, for your timely and informative presentation. As chair of the Research Council, it's my pleasure to moderate our question and answer session. Just as a reminder, please use the microphone when asking questions so that those viewing via the web stream can hear your questions. And I'll start off with a question, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
So out of curiosity, for an individual under constant conditions, how stable is actually the gut microbiome? Could fluctuation in the microbiome be correlated with diseases that also have kind of a fluctuation?
So our microbiome, as we're developing early in life, is relatively unstable. But by the time you reach adulthood, it's almost stable as a brick. So there's some daily changes and fluctuations that happen that with our diet, with small changes you might have in your diet. If you have a whopping dose of antibiotics or something, that'll make it. But a short-term change, but those are typically short-term changes, and it comes back to it. It's a very resilient ecosystem.
Thanks.
In your research, did you serve sterile grain to those mice, and what did you sample, feces or just the output from to determine the microbiome?
So typically, we're sampling what's easy, which is fecal material, especially if we're doing hundreds to thousands of animals in an experiment. If it's a small number and we're doing a very detailed experiment and it's a terminal experiment, then the animals are sacrificed, and then some of the tissues can be gathered and we can look at more internal parts. And depending upon the nature of the experiment, the feed may or may not be sterilized. Okay, so there may be things coming in on the feed as well in the experiments. But with germ-free animals or animals that have been conventionalized, those use feed that is sterilized.
You said germ-free animals are the mice are weird. Tell us.
Yes, meaning that their immune systems don't develop properly, their gut tissues don't look the way normal in terms of their structure, their microstructures that they're formed. Metabolically, they're a little bit different. They eat more. They have to eat more. So there's some very different characteristics those animals have.
We have a question from one of our viewers on the live web stream. I'm wondering about the impact of this work on our students. Has there been an increase in undergraduate interest in these new fields in food science and technology? Is the gut microbiome becoming a new recruiting tool? Dr. Benson's enthusiasm must have a positive influence on students.
Well, if only enthusiasm was what it took to get students through school. We're certainly doing everything we can to start introducing these concepts into our courses. And I'll say one of the challenges that it causes is within a discipline, we face this in every discipline. There's a certain amount of disciplinary material that has to be broadcast to the students and has to be taught to the students. And a lot of these studies you're seeing are very interdisciplinary. And so it gets to be difficult to make sure the students get enough of the discipline as well as some of the newer stuff. So, of course, we inject it every opportunity we get, and our enthusiasm is usually there.
Does the current business plan for the land-grant university systems and its close ties to industrial agriculture permit it to meet your challenge?
That's a good question. Harvey, I think that's part of our challenge as an academic institution, even though there is the land-grant mission. Part of our challenge as an academic institution is to create that culture where economics is not the sole driving force. And I think we have to really start considering the fact that long-term economics will be a driving force. You can see how it was driving in terms of the outcomes of our current food system. Healthcare is a huge burden on our culture right now. And I would suggest that we should be the ones that change it. This isn't going to be done at a medical school. You won't find a medical school that'll have the capabilities to reach all the way back to the agricultural engines like we can here at a land-grant institution. So I think that we're not only poised to do it, but we must be the ones to do it.
Andy, the gut microbiome is typically characterized in the domain of bacteria. Could you comment a little bit on the other domains of life? Eukaryota.
So the archaea are present there. They're small in terms of number, but large in terms of impact. And so those guys are involved in hydrogen cycling, and depending upon which type of host you may be involved in, definitely involved in participating in methane production as well, but certainly involved in the hydrogen cycling. Other forms of life that we find there, the phage, we know that these are viruses that attack bacteria. Phage are also there and very abundant and probably contributing as well, although we don't really understand how they're contributing to the structure of the system. We understand how phage do it much better out in the ocean than we do in our guts. As far as higher organism fungi, they seem to be, Heather Helen Adams, who's sitting right next to you, could tell you a lot more about that than I could, but the fungal content seems to be a minor component, with the exception of perhaps Canada. And we don't really understand yet what they're doing, if they're doing much at all. That's the representation, at least in humans.
In one of your tests, you showed that you gave the test animals a high-fat diet.
Yes.
But the different fats have such dramatically different effects. Can you be more specific as to what kind of fat you gave them?
It depends on which diet you're asking or which experiment you're asking about. There's multiple experiments we've talked about in there. Yes, we certainly take that into effect. So different ratios are very carefully calibrated diets that the animals are given.
Well, if there's no further questions, please join me in thanking Dr. Benson again.
Andy, what a fantastic presentation. We're very appreciative of you taking time preparing your presentation, but explaining in a way that we can all understand. Very, very, very exciting. So as a token of our appreciation, we have a tradition of giving you something that you can look at every day and smile. So this is a framed copy of the poster that you've seen around the campus.
Oh my God.
And so this is for your own office, and thank you very, very much.
Appreciate it. Thank you.